Okay, my wonderful students, let's begin. We just handed back exams, and if we didn't get to you right away this morning, we'll try to get you after class, because I think we're going to dismiss a few minutes early today, unless you guys don't want to. Okay. All right, let's talk about SSG for a minute. We're going to have another round of SSG, and it'll be a separate sign-up, so you can sign up with a completely different SSG leader if you can get in there. And I've already set up several times and places. If you are an SSG leader listening to my voice and you haven't gotten me your time and place yet, you want to do that. I've got Kate Tomlinson here. Here's Bethany and Caroline and Miles. We got a couple more. Alexia. Alexia, you're in this section, right? No? Yes, okay. Yeah, Alexia's on there. A bunch of other people haven't gotten it, but they will be. And they'll be inserted into the schedule page. Now, I put a link to the schedule page right on the home page. So if you want to look at that, perfect, lovely, wonderful. All right? It's available right now. And I'll be updating it over the next 48 hours or so. I want you to look for the red swing line stapler. So look for the red stapler, and you'll know that you're on the schedule page. And then just look down the list and see what you like. Now, the plan is to open it up Friday evening again, which last time we did this, there was a real stampede. And so, but I haven't decided exactly what time I'm going to open it up. Could be 5 o'clock again till 7 for group 1. Could be 6 to 8 for group 1. It could be something else. But I'll let you know in class on Thursday. So be ready. And if you're in group 2, kindly wait until the end of that 2-hour period, and then you can get in there. It'll be a, you know, if I go 5 to 7 again, at 7:01, there's going to be like a complete buffalo stampede through there. Like last time, everything filled up at like 7:05. It was pretty amazing. Because there were spots. There were people that, you know, I announced it. They still didn't want to sign up for, I don't know, easy bonus points. You know, but that's what they did. Well, that's what they didn't do. Another bonus point activity I want to just review with you. I'll be releasing this in the next, I think tomorrow sometime. And it's going to be in discussions. And it's a discussion thread in which you post a brand new question of your own creation, multiple choice, for which you create 4 or 5 options. One of them has to be correct. And then you post it along with a study tip of, you know, where another student can study up on the topic of your question. And it'll be in discussions area, and I will grade it. Darianne and our TA, Nisha, will be reading it, and I'll be reading it, and we'll be commenting. And if your question is good enough, then I will use it on the final exam, and you will have earned 2 bonus points, which is a nice chunk of change, especially considered we're down at the bare end of the semester, and every little bit helps. So for those of you that weren't able to get SSG bonus point activity before exam 3, you could definitely go in there and give this a shot. Now everybody gets to write 1 question, right? So make it a good one. If it's not perfect, I may give you some comments, or Darian may make a suggestion or a comment, or Nisha the same. And then you can rewrite it, you know, revise it, and then that might be good. Now, question.
How many questions are you looking to take from this discussion to put on the test?
As many as are good. You get one. All right? Everybody, you know, so theoretically there's going to be about 600 questions in there. But not everybody will try it. But if you do, we'll read it and we'll make a judgment. You know, maybe ask you to revise it a little bit. And I've used many questions in the past. I like using them, but they have to be really good. And, you know, sometimes students just use, don't reuse a clicker question. Don't reuse a homework question that I've already asked in the homeworks, you know, because I'm not going to accept those. But it's got to be something new. So go from your notes and, you know, be creative. Okay? This is one where you're writing the question. Gordon. I will not be indicating in any way. The answer to your question is no. I'm not going to indicate in any way before the test which ones I'm using. I'll give the grade after the test. All right? That column is muted, and you can't judge by my comments. You know, you'll post something, and then Darianne might comment, I might comment, and I might say, boy, this is nice, you know, but it still might not be useful for the test. All right? And so if I do choose it, you'll see it on the test. That's the first indication. But if you all study that discussion area, there's a high probability that you may see 10 or even more questions on the final for the second time because you've already studied them in that discussion area and seen our discussion about them, comments and so forth. So it's a great study tool as well. So it's possible, you know, matter of fact, you might not get selected for 2 bonus points. But if you study it carefully, you might get another 10 points. That's pretty nice, right? You might score 10 points higher on the final, and that, you know, which is good. You know, you want to do that. You want to, you know, put a total beat down on the final exam. It's going to be hard, but it can be done. It has been done. So, so that's that. Now there's another question here. The question was, do you only get the bonus points if I choose the question? And that's answered in 3B. Yes, if it's good enough, and only if it's good enough for me to use. So if I use it, you get 2 points. You'll see on the test. You'll see it. Now, don't make it a matching. Just make it a regular multiple choice. And don't make it true-false. You know, because you know what? I'm even thinking about not having any true-false on the final because I see a lot of people going, yeah, Dr. B, good. Because a lot of, I don't know, I always thought true-false was pretty cinchy, but a lot of people don't like it. But anyways, make this multiple choice and make it a good one. And you'll get 2 bonus points, plus you'll get, you better get that one right on the test. And then if you study the rest of the discussion area, you might get another 10 questions easy, fast, on the final. And that's what you want to do. All right? Now, my other comment to you is do not make a calculate. Make it a concepts question. In other words, I guess you could make a real simple calculation, but nothing bodacious. Okay. All right. And we'll let you know what we think of it. Any other questions? I have a question for the room, for everyone in here. I have a Mac. I was trying to find a font this morning that it looks, it's, you know, for a regular alphabet, but it looks like it's Elvish. Does anybody know if there's a font that fits that look? Nobody knows. Maybe we should invent a font. Elvish. Well, you know, like in The Lord of the Rings. Because we're actually going to talk about The Lord of the Rings a little bit indirectly today. And to do that, to get to that concept, the One Ring, the Lord of the Rings, we have to get back to Rutherford's experiment. Now, he was... trying to figure out alpha particles, he bombarded a thin foil of gold with alpha particles. He found a many backscattering events. He measured them, he counted them, and so forth. We have talked about this already. And from this, he was able to make some deductions. This will be new. What his deductions were beyond or on top of his deduction of the nucleus. Question?
Can you tell us what the class average was for the test?
No, I can't. Test is not finished. I have that. The question was, can you tell us what the class average is? The answer is no, because I'm still messing around with the clicker points. Okay, so I don't really know what the, you know, full scores are for. Nobody knows. So, but I'll try to let you know when I do. I have that down. Okay, so alpha particles. Now, one of the things that he analyzed, you know, he had all these, he sent all these alpha particles in one direction, and then like smithereens in a Roadrunner cartoon, they went off in all directions. And he counted them up, he measured the angles, he measured the frequency, you know, how many per minute, how many per hour, and it gives you a rough probability of, you know, where the energy is distributed and stuff in the scattering interaction. And when he analyzed that using a ton of calculus and a ton of trig, he was able to figure out an upper limit on the size of the gold limit. Now, an upper limit means it's like saying the gold nucleus cannot be any larger than this, and then filling out a number, some number of nanometers, or some number of picometers, or something like that. So here's some of his conclusions, that it was very teeny compared to the atom, and that in fact it was 1/100,000th of the size of the atom. So diameter for diameter, 1/100,000. And to put that in perspective, we're going to do an analogy in a minute where we kind of work out what it would be like in human terms. But the basic model that he posited for the atom was simply that electrons are orbiting a nucleus that's really small and positive, somewhat like planets orbit the sun. Now, we don't think that anymore. We have a little bit fancier theory for that called quantum theory. But the Rutherford theory was pretty good. It was a nice piece of work, and it was helpful. Now, this model, electrons orbiting the atom, that is why you see pictures like this, you know, where there's something in the middle and then little things zipping around. But now this picture here, it's very popular to see diagrams like that, but it's not to scale, not even close. All right, so, and this is an atom with several electrons. Let's see how many we got there, 3, 5, 6. So this is 6 electrons, whatever that is on the periodic table. Let's see, that's going to be, I don't know, somewhere on the periodic table. I can't think of it off the top of my head. Anyways, let's do a little more accurate analogy. We're going to build up the scale model based on this. We're going to say that a regular human basketball, for which we know the diameter, is going to take the place of the nucleus. And then we're going to build this or figure out how big that would make an atom. So we scale up to the we scale the nucleus up to a basketball size, and then figure out how big that makes the atom itself. Because remember, it's 1 to 100,000 diameter for diameter. So here's the proportion, nucleus to atom. And so here's the question that we're going to try to think about. And this is the kind of thing that they were thinking about. You know, if the basketball is one, then, you know, what's the width of that atom? What's the width of 100,000 basketballs? Well, we could figure that out. It's not bodacious. It's a fairly big distance. But, you know, in real life, a basketball's diameter is about 24 centimeters. Yeah, it's about this big, 24 centimeters. And that's 0.24 meters. So multiply that by 100,000. So 100,000 of those would be 24,000 meters or 24 kilometers. And that, my wonderful students, is big. So you're starting to see, whoa, that atom is a big thing with little teeny things in the middle of it. And that's what Rutherford's deduction was. Okay, now 24 kilometers, that's about 14 miles. All right? That's basically halfway across Orange County. And you may say to yourself, what's 14 miles away from here? You know, what's 14 miles away from campus? All right, asked and answered. We're going to answer that now. Okay, for example, Student Union at UCF, main campus. What's 14 miles away from there? How about Orlando International Airport? Now, we're going to put this all together. Make a note. And I figured this out. It's amazing what you could do with Google. I figured this out. You know, you get the GPS coordinates of the subway in the Student Union. You know, not the information desk. Not student government up, let's say, for subway, you know, and GPS knows the difference. Same thing with Starbucks and Terminal A. And it works out to 21.554 kilometers, so that's almost 24. 13.383 miles, that's a good piece of mileage. Okay, so the atom's going to be a little bit bigger than that. You know, another couple kilometers, another mile or two. So the upshot of this, all right, if a nucleus really is scaled up to the size of a basketball, then first of all, you're looking for a basketball somewhere in here. And you're looking for a little teeny basketball. This map, it wouldn't even be a pixel on this map. It might even be a thousandth of a pixel on this map. All right? And so you're looking for that basketball somewhere between here, but yet an electron is orbiting it. Electron knows exactly where it is. And the electron's orbiting that thing. So the electron's up here at UCF or maybe down at OIA, and it's electromagnetically interacting with that basketball, you know, somewhere in there. Whoa. We got a really incredible system. And the upshot is, you know, most of that space in the atom is empty space. So really, you know, you think about a tabletop, solid, right? Yeah, solid, but it's made of atoms, and most atoms are empty space. So what is it? You know, this whole idea of solidity and rigidity is something that we would use, but an atom would never think of things in that way. You know, if you were down to the size, if I could shrink you down from the size of a normal human being to, you know, like a little space alien the size of a proton, then you would never think about solid things. And what we're going to study today is what you would think about, and that's the quantum world. Now, to get to that, I want to ask you another question. Here it is. Why don't these electrons radiate away some light energy and collapse into the nucleus? After all, the electrons are negative, right? the nucleus is positive, right? So why don't they just get sucked right down? You know, like a baseball. You let it out. You're up there in the space shuttle or the space station. You open the hatch. You throw a baseball straight downward to the Earth. Good. It goes straight to the Earth. Well, if it's made of titanium alloy or something, it won't burn up on reentry. You know, so you drop something like that, and it'll go straight back down to the Earth. Why don't electrons do that? Why are atoms stable? I mean, because at the first instant of the Big Bang, all the atoms should have collapsed. I mean, you try it, you put them together, you know, they're orbiting, but if they should just get sucked right down into the nucleus, bing, no atom. It's all mushed together. But that's not what happens. And we're going to try to attack that particular problem. Right? But the way to do that is to ask you a few clicker questions now about rainbows. And you may be thinking to yourself, Leah, Dr. B, why are you talking about rainbows? I don't see any unicorns around class. You know, Harris Engineering Center, 125. There's no unicorns. There's no rain. But everybody's seen a rainbow. So I got a couple questions for you about rainbows. And these concepts are going to help you attack this idea of the quantum world and why those atoms are stable, why they don't collapse. Here we go. Question one. This optical device, if you've had sixth grade science and you remember any of it, you probably know at least one of the answers here. Go ahead and vote. And we'll think about the Elvish situation a little bit later. Ten seconds to vote. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Yeah, I guess you guys kind of know your stuff, but actually, C is also correct. Good. Oh, you know what? I want to make an announcement. This has nothing to do with rainbows or anything. It's kind of serious. I don't want anybody to use cell phones during exams. All right? You're not allowed to do that. And if we catch you doing that on the final, you're probably going to get an F on the final and probably expelled from UCF for cheating. Okay, so we don't want to do any of that. All right? And I don't want, bring a regular calculator, you'll be fine. Do your studying, but don't be talking to people on your cell phone. It's not allowed. I can't be any more serious than that. And I can't be more serious than to say, if we catch you doing that, it's going to be instantaneous academic death. And we've expelled people for that in the past, and we'll do it again. I don't have any hesitation about doing that. So, a little somber note. Okay, another question about rainbows. Okay, here we go. Question number two. Which color has the shortest wavelength? You remember that? Remember the wavelength limits for Roy G. Biv? Nanometers. Remember which one? I see people going back in their notes. I'll give you a minute. Go back in your notes and look it up. Yeah.
What's the optical tweezers?
Optical tweezers?
Yeah, is it just like a tweezer you put your eyeball on
The question from the front of the room was, what is an optical tweezer? It's an electronic device that they use for moving different parts, really small little things about the size of a cell, or parts of a cell. They can move it around. I don't really know exactly. I've never used one, but I believe it uses lasers and stuff like that. It's pretty fancy. But optical tweezers, yeah, they have them. Look it up on the internets. All right, 10 seconds to vote. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Let's see what you guys got. Let me see what you got. We got some splaining to do. We got some studying to do. Yeah, answer is violet. If you answered red, you're exactly sorry. Maybe this sounds cruel, but you're exactly wrong. The answer is violet. Red would be the answer to the longest wavelength. Okay, so just the opposite. Now, why are we talking about that? Well, the structure of hydrogen can be understood in terms of the color of light that's produced by hydrogen once it passes through a prism or a diffraction grating. So we're going to talk about this quantum theory of hydrogen. And the beginning of the quantum theory is this assumption that only certain orbital levels are allowed for the electron. And so it has, in particular, this very smallest, where my cursor is there, the very smallest dashed circle, that's the orbit that is lowest energy. You know, it's just like gravitational potential energy, GPE. The higher up you are, the more potential energy, GPE, that you've got. And similarly with the electrical interaction. So down low, that's the one with the lowest potential energy. And this proviso, or this assumption of the quantum theory, is that there's a ground state and that it's separated spatially from the second orbital state, and that you can count the orbital states. In other words, you don't have a continuous infinity of orbital states. You know, like the space shuttle can be at, you know, any altitude pretty much that it wants. It's in a gravitational system. It's not in a quantum system. But in the quantum theory of hydrogen, only certain altitudes are allowed. Now, you have to be able to number them. So number them, the smallest circle, n equals 1. Next circle out, n equals 2. Next circle out after that, n equals 3. And I've got 4 orbits spaced out. And notice that my electron is out there on orbit number 4. Now, the thing about the second part of the theory is, if an electron is on one of the outer orbits, it can change to an inner orbit. That's what's called a quantum leap. It can jump down there. Not a problem. And when it does, it emits a photon of light, a very specific photon of light. Now, for hydrogen, when you go from the N equals 3 level down to the N equals 2 level, you get a famous color. It's called H alpha, hydrogen alpha. It's red. It's a beautiful red. And I'll show you a picture of it. You can look up hydrogen of spectrum. Excuse me, spectrum of hydrogen on the internets, and you find a zillion pictures of the spectrum of hydrogen. So from n equals 3 down to n equals 2, it emits a photon. If a photon of the right color crashes in, it'll boost the electron up from n equals 2 to n equals 3, just the other way. So an incoming photon of the right color gets you up to a higher orbit. Once you're up at a higher orbit, you deorbit to a lower one by emitting a photon of a very precise color. Now, the guys that figured this out for hydrogen were Niels Bohr and Albert Einstein. Niels Bohr was the one that kind of figured it out, and Albert Einstein made some significant additions to the theory. Here they are. Oh, they're probably talking about chicks or something. I don't know. Some scientific, but you know, you go to these scientific conferences, and half the time, the guys, these physics eggheads at the conference, you know, when they give a paper, you know, at the conference, and then during the break, they're talking about anything else, you know, about, you know, cars or babes or, you know, whatnot, politics. It's crazy. Anyway. Quantum theory of hydrogen. Here, let's kind of work through it. First, you number the orbits. And then you go by this theory, that as the electron drops to a lower electrical potential energy orbit, so from n equals 3 down to n equals 2, it emits a photon with that missing energy. So certain orbits are allowed, and therefore certain energy deltas, delta E, or delta EPE, is going to be specified between each orbit, between each pair of orbits. And once that's specified, that energy goes into the photon that's emitted. All right? And that is one of the reasons. Well, we think that hydrogen works this way, but it's under the assumption that there's nothing lower than n equals 1. Now, on the space shuttle or the space station, it could, well, we want those up in permanent orbit. But, you know, the rescue the crew capsules that they send down to Earth, they come back down to any other orbit that they like, all the way down to ground level. But hydrogen, no. Atoms, no. In general, even molecules, they have a ground state below which they're not going to go. So, The thing about these different energy levels, these different orbits, is that they produce specific energies and therefore specific wavelengths and frequencies of light. Now, for hydrogen, this is what you've got. Now, I want you to eyeball this carefully. Don't look at me. Look at the colors. They're kind of washed out, but hopefully you can see H alpha, that beautiful red line over there on the right. And then over here, that's called H beta, the second of the visible lines emitted by electrons deorbiting from different energy levels to lower energy levels in a hydrogen atom. H gamma, kind of a blue, dark blue. H delta, kind of a purpley blue. And there's a really faint one. I don't know if the lights allow you to see it, but all the way over here on the left, there's another one. I guess it's H epsilon, way down in the purple violets. Very purpley blue. It's pretty faint. Now, H alpha, that color, that's red. That's n equals 3 down to n equals 2. H beta, this kind of aqua, almost kind of a tealish color. That's n equals 4 down to n equals 2. So if you have a photon way up there at n equals 4 and it jumps right down to n equals 2, ding, that emits this color of a photon. And then H gamma, it's way up there at n equals 5. It's way out there past the space station. Okay, and when it jumps down to n equals 2, ding, it emits this blue photon. And these are the only colors allowed because only certain orbital transitions are allowed because only certain orbits are allowed. Let me repeat that. These are the only colors allowed because only certain orbital transitions are allowed, and that's because only certain orbits are allowed. Here's the last one. H delta, n equals 6 down to n equals 2. And hey, you guys, these colors, this set of specific colors forms the Balmer series for hydrogen. And it is like the universal fingerprint. If an astronomer is looking at a star and he sends a star through the starlight from his telescope into a prism or into a diffraction grating, if there's a lot of hydrogen, he'll see these spectral lines. Whenever he sees this specific color of color, whenever he sees this specific combination of colors, he says to himself, hydrogen. And we've known this for a long time. We didn't understand it until the days of Bohr and Einstein and later. But yeah, this is the universal fingerprint for hydrogen. If you take helium and you do the same thing, you take hydrogen and you put it in a glass tube and then hook it up to high voltage, it'll glow. And these are the colors that hydrogen will produce. If you do the same thing with helium, it'll produce different colors. Helium looks, it's got a lot of yellows in it, and it looks almost like salmon color. Neon. The reason you guys haven't seen any of these spectra is because we can't turn off. I normally do it every semester, first day of classes. We can't turn the lights off. You have to have a dark classroom, so we haven't been able to see it. It's on YouTube, these different colors. But neon is got a lot. When you do the same thing with neon, you put a tube of neon, or you put a glass tube, you fill it with neon, and you zap it with high voltage, it'll emit a lot of light of specific colors, most of them red. And that's why you see so many red neon lights for advertising. It's lovely the way it works. And we have the fingerprints for hydrogen, helium, neon, sodium, carbon, oxygen. We have all the we have fingerprints for molecules. Proteins, you know, the protein in your eye, rhodopsin, retinal, we've got the spectra for that. It's, you know, it might not be in the Roy G. Biv colors, but we got them. Ultraviolet, maybe? Infrared? Yeah, we got them. But here's the question. Why does it stop at the ground state, N equals 1? What is it that nature... Yeah, it's like nature's arbitrarily saying, nope, that's all you get. N equals 1, no closer. And Niels Bohr, made that his assumption, but he didn't know why that should be true. He made the assumption. He was able to figure out all these wavelengths based on his theory, and it jived with experiment, but he didn't know why there should be a ground state. You know, that he didn't know why the atom was stable. He made this mathematical theory, and it matched up with observation, but he didn't know why. But the guy that did figure it out is named Louis de Broglie. Very famous guy from Paris, France. And he's the one for whom this question got an answer. And his answer is that electrons have wave properties. What? I thought an electron was a particle. You know, like a little electronic, you know, a little teeny baseball or a little teeny planet orbiting the nucleus. And de Broglie says, yeah, that's a nice idea, but if you think about an electron as a wave with a wavelength and a frequency and energy and a momentum, then you can, and you know, baseballs have momentum, baseballs have kinetic energy, planets have momentum, planets have kinetic energy, but we don't think of a planet as having a wavelength or a baseball. But de Broglie said, think about an electron that way, and it all works out. So here's what he said. You think about these numbered orbits, you know, N equals 1, N equals 2. And they were all trying to grapple the simplest atom of all, the hydrogen atom. But we've since applied it to other atoms, you know, helium and so forth. Anyways, you number them up. And then you say to yourself, okay, instead of instead of a little BB or a little baseball or a little planet going around and around on the circle, what if I had a wave going around that circle? You know, we had a demonstration up here. Did we do that, Darian? The waves, the slinky?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We did that demonstration. Excuse me. We did that demonstration up here. And, you know, we excited the fundamental state. You know, it was one bump oscillating to one dip. What kind of wave was that called in that demonstration? What kind of wave? Remember? Raise your hand if you remember the name of that wave. What was the... Sarah? No, that excited described one of the modes. One of the other, you know, ways. But all the different modes, fundamental mode, first excited state, second excited state and stuff, they're all a certain kind of wave. Remember what that word was? Colin? No, it was related to that for sound, but what am I doing right now? I'm standing. It's a standing wave. Okay? So think of a standing wave. Instead of going a straight point A to point B, think of a standing wave going around. And it's interfering with itself. Here's a picture. And if you look up de Broglie electron wave, you'll see bunches of pictures like this. Down here, this little teeny one, get my cursor down there, that's the ground state, or as we described it in class, the fundamental mode. Okay, the fundamental mode when we're doing, you know, guitar strings or the slinky up here in front. In the atom, it's called the ground state. Okay, and that's the one where you have exactly one bump and one dip all the way around the orbit. The orbit is just the perfect size, and the energy is just the perfect size, and the momentum is just the perfect size to have one full bump or one full dip all the way around. Now, Sarah, here's this next one. There's your first excited state. And you remember in the first excited state here, we got a bump alternating with, we got a bump and a dip, alternating with a dip and a bump. Okay, same thing here. Only it's going around in a circle. And guess what? This is one of the weirdest things, a profound mystery that nobody understands why this should be the case. But this is a case, this all works. All the wavelengths work out. You can calculate them out perfectly. But it only works if you think of an electron as having a wave that is interfering with itself. Whoa. A wave interfering with itself. Now, so far, we've talked about waves, you know, one from the coast of West Africa and one from the coast of Nova Scotia meeting in the middle of the ocean and then interacting and interfering. But this is an electron behaving as a wave, interfering with itself. Now, I want to compare this to a guitar. Right, the quantum guitar. Thinking about a guitar. Raise your hand if you play the guitar. One, couple, three, four. Okay, there's a bunch of you. Good. If you play guitar, or even if you've ever seen someone playing guitar, you know that when they get it out of their guitar case, first thing they got to do is tune it up. Make sure it's on key. You know, make sure it's tuned. So they take out their little device and they strum a chord, or they strum one of the strings, and maybe tighten it up or loosen it up, and they try it again, and maybe tighten it up or loosen it up, and try it again until they get it right on the money. And then they do the next string. You know, they strum the next string, and tighten it up or tune it, loosen it up, and you know, just keep doing that until they get all six strings. Now, they don't hit any of the frets. They just do... What is it, neck to bridge? Is that what they call it? Is that, guitarists, come on, is that the terminology? The neck and the bridge? Yeah, okay. So that's your length. That's like the distance between me and Darian. When you strum a single string of a guitar, you get one note if it's tuned. If it's not tuned, it sounds horrible because you're getting all kinds of harmonics and, you know, you're not getting that good, pure fundamental. Okay, so the guitar is tuned. Write this down. A tuned guitar. One string, one note. One note, one pitch. Because that's what you're listening to. You're listening to the pitch. One pitch, that's the same as frequency. So you get your guitar, you tune it up, you got one frequency on each string. One frequency, it's a wave. You know, it's the fundamental that you're listening to for the most part. And it has a certain wavelength. Right? So here we go. Let's make a note of this. One note, one pitch. One pitch, one frequency. One frequency, one wavelength. And that's just like this atom. You know, one orbit of a certain size, one wavelength. That's it. And, you know, your guitar is quantized. Now, let me draw your attention. And we got one more question coming up, so don't leave yet. Take a look at figure 8.5 in your e-text. It's a little bit simpler picture of this. And this is the reason that atoms are stable. The quantum, and I like to compare it to the quantum guitar. So here's what de Broglie's relation is. You know, he said, all right, how do you figure out the actual wavelength? Well, you have the size of the orbit, right? And that's going to have a certain orbital energy and a certain orbital momentum. Now, we didn't figure out orbital momentum, but we could have done that. It's not that hard. And he says, take the momentum, MV, and divide it into Planck's radiation constant, H. And that will be the wavelength of the electron as it goes around the orbit. So the momentum state, P equals MV, controls the size and the wavelength. And it fits perfectly into what we have measured for hydrogen. This is the de Broglie relation. Lambda equals H over P. And I have a quicker question for you here. Go ahead and write that down. Lambda equals H over P. H is Planck's constant. Question 3. All right, which electron has the shortest wavelength? Look at that formula, lambda equals H over P. Now, H is a constant, Planck's constant. Shortest wavelength, smallest quotient. Seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, zero. We're not. You haven't been this. All right, go ahead.